Hello everyone, this is Dude Blender, and let's jump right in. Using the right nodes can help spice up your Blender materials, so we'll be looking at three of them. The geometry node's pointiness output, the ambient occlusion node, and the layer weight's facing output. We'll begin with the pointiness output of the geometry node. This node provides plenty of vectorial information about the surface of your mesh, such as the position, the orientation of the shading point, and where it's being viewed from. It also gives us access to more sophisticated calculations, such as the pointiness of the shading point. This tells us how convex or concave a shading point is. Note that this output, not the whole node, but this specific output, will only work in cycles. Now, to accentuate the information of this output, we'll often use it together with a color ramp, and we'll bring these lighters closer together. There are several applications for this. For example, in this photo that I took at the Louvre, the Sphinx's paw is shinier and darker in this area because it's where people can easily reach out and touch it, and all this touching paw polishes the rock and also makes it dirtier. However, the crevices between the fingers are less accessible, and in Blender we could just use different materials for both areas. Now, since this area is more convex and this area is more concave, the pointiness output could help us to quickly map which material should go into which area. Another common use is to replicate edge wear, like in this picture, where the paint tends to chip away from the edges, and that's what we're going to do. For this video, I've already set the materials up to keep it short and to focus on the important nodes. I'll just explain the materials very quickly. Here I've got two BSDF shaders. One is a simple gray and metallic material for the parts where the paint has fallen off, and this one is just a shiny purple non-metallic material for the paint. I also have a Voronoi texture connected to a color ramp to create some chipped parts on the sides of the cube. Since this eventually goes to a bump node, and we want the transition between the parts with and without paint to be very sharp, I changed this to constant. And now this is the area where I want to focus. As I mentioned before, we connect the pointiness to a color ramp. Since this is a cube with a very small bevel, the transition between the pointy and the flat shading points is very fast, so I also changed this to constant. If I visualize this color ramp, you can see that as I move this slider, the edge very quickly disappears, so we just need to move it to a point where we can clearly see the edge. To add some imperfection, I subtracted a noise texture. You usually don't want your shapes and effects to be mathematically perfect and symmetrical because it looks unrealistic, unless, of course, that's the style that you're going for, but otherwise it's a good idea to add some randomness to your shaders. I also connected the noise texture to a color ramp, and again changed this to constant as we did before in the Voronoi texture. Now with this setup, we can use this slider to control how much of the paint has fallen off of the edges of the cube, and you can always adjust the scale and other parameters of the noise texture. Then I inverted this so that I could subtract the Voronoi texture from it and have all of the parts without paint to be lower in the bump node, as you can see here. Now, a cool thing about making materials with these nodes is that if you apply this to another shape, such as a monkey, you'll see that it works because it calculates the pointiness of each specific geometry. Of course, you would have to adjust some of the parameters for every specific shape, but you can see the power of these materials. Now to the ambient occlusion. We've got this pumpkin material with a wavy bump made by adding a wave texture and the noise texture. Over here, we've got the base color and the noise texture that we are using to create these bruises on the skin of the pumpkin. We've also got this shader with a darker and rougher color for the parts where the ambient occlusion will be stronger. And up here, we've got the ambient occlusion setup. We also usually connect the ambient occlusion node to a color ramp to strengthen the effect. This node calculates how much of the shading point is covered from light based on its shape and the objects around it. The calculation is based purely on geometry, and it doesn't take into account the lights of the scene. In this other photo from the same trip to Paris, it's easy to see that some parts of the geometry get less light than others, and the ambient occlusion calculation replicates this effect for more realistic scenes. Coincidentally, those same areas are usually where grime and dust also collect, so you can also use this node to that effect. The node itself is quite simple. It has two outputs, color and AO. If you don't add color to the ambient occlusion, you can use either output. Samples is the quality of the calculation. The more samples, of course, is better, but you should be aware that this particular node is quite slow when using cycles, so try to keep this at a lower lower number while yet achieving the quality that you want. Inside calculates the occlusion inside of the shape. If I tick it, you'll see that it goes black. But if I go into the pumpkin, you can see that the effect is on the inside. Only local will only calculate ambient occlusion from the object's own geometry, ignoring other objects on the scene, such as the floor. If I uncheck it, you can see the difference. You can add color to the ambient occlusion map if you want to, but in this application, we're using it as a mask to determine which material will be applied in which parts of the geometry, so we'll just leave it white. The distance determines how close a geometry has to be to have an effect on the output. I've also added a gamma node after the color ramp to intensify the effect even more, as this goes into the factor of a mixed shader. This way, the parts that are more occluded will take the darker, rougher material, accounting for the dust and dirt that might be accumulated, and also for the lower amount of light that would reach these parts. Here's the render with the occlusion, and here's without. I will recommend one thing though: if you can achieve your desired effect with the pointiness output of the geometry node we saw before, you should choose that one over this one, because the cycle's render times with the ambient occlusion node may get significantly higher if you use it on large surfaces or on many objects on the scene. You can see here that with the occlusion, the render time was 46 seconds, and without, it was 35. So a full 10 seconds. Last but definitely not least, we'll take a look at the layer weight node. This one is very cool, as it provides information about the angle that the shading point is facing in relation to the camera. You can actually make pretty interesting materials very quickly. Let me show you. If I make a capsule with a new material, add two shaders of different color, mix them, and control the mix with the facing output of a layer weight node, we can immediately see what the node does. By adjusting the blend, you can accentuate the effect even more. The Fresnel output does a similar thing, but with a more subtle effect. There is also a Fresnel node that does a similar thing, but it uses the index of refraction. So with this one, you can make more realistic or accurate materials. For this application, I'll just go ahead and use the facing output because I want to have more control and I'm not necessarily looking to make a perfectly realistic material. I'm using this photo as reference, specifically this balloon. It looks more transparent in the center and less so around the edges. You can even see the balloon behind it in this area, but as you approach the edges, it disappears. It also seems to be more reflective as you look at the surface at an angle. I have a semi-transparent shader and a diffuse shader, and I control the mix with a layer weight node connected to a color ramp. By adjusting the blend value and the sliders, I can very precisely define the angle where the balloon is transparent and the fall off of the effect. Then I can mix this shader with a glossy and control this new mix with another color ramp connected to the facing output. In this way, I can fine tune how reflective I want the sides of the balloon to look. Since I don't want the sides to look completely glossy, I'll just leave this in a light grayish tone. This is a close up of the effect, and you can see the transparency in the center of the balloon, and it's more reflective on the sides, just as we saw in the reference. There you go, three nodes to take your materials to the next level. That's it for today. Drop a like, comment, and subscribe if you liked the video, and connect with me on TikTok and Instagram with the handle @dude_blender. I'm Dude Blender, happy blending, and check out some of these other videos in the channel.